Good morning, everybody. It's time for us to worship together. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. That's what we celebrate today. We celebrate as people with a cloud of witnesses around us to see us through this world.
Free,
amen, 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 amen.
Falling down like rain, love that I can't explain.
Darkest place, life, even in the pain, feels like coming home. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I'm free, amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
This mask is trying to get free at last. There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead. I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. On eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith will beat my heart. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before
the ringing of the bells by our children as they welcome us to worship. May we remember that we were once two churches, now we are one. Now may we stand for the opening song for all the saints, verses 1, 2, 4, and 6.
Be with you.
And also with you.
And I'm watching Beth. I hope you guys are watching Beth. She's directing you down there. I love it. I love it. It's good to see you all. We are going to do one of my favorite services of the whole year. It's a celebration of our saints. I could ask you a quiz. How many saints are in our room today? Gobs and gobs is probably the best answer we can come up with. So saints are all those who love God. So saints are living, and saints are living on this in this time and place, and saints are those who've gone on before us. Saints are those who are living face-to-face with Jesus right now. And so the excitement of this service is we get to celebrate in a multitude of ways. We will, during the ministry time, we are going to be calling for three of our folks to join in membership with us. That gives us an opportunity to remember why it is we're here in the first place. We get to go through our vows together and affirm the vows that these three ladies are taking. And then later on in the service, we will have a naming of the members of our church or the close family members of our church who have died, and we're going to do this year, we're going to do right before COVID and as we most recently remember. And so we're going to start with Don Woodward. And I want to bring Don to your mind because we will be making a memorial gift in his honor, which will be our baptismal font, and that will be here before we know it. So we will be honoring the saints that have gone on, as we name them and light candles in their memory. If other people come in and they have photos in their hand or in a frame, invite them to come forward, even if it interrupts everything, because that's why we're here. And have them put their photos up here for us. We'll share in a time of communion today, which means you get to stay seated. I know you'll be disappointed. There are no graham crackers. There are also none of those gnarly little cups that are hard to open. We are going to bring you little cups of juice and little pieces of bread. Yeah. And that's the first time I've done that with you. I don't know how long it's been since you've had communion together, but oh my. We're going to do it because we can do it safely, and it's time. All right. So we do remember the fullness of God's grace and glory, and let me share with you as we start off, and if I can't see these tiny words, somebody else pick up the pace. All righty, are you ready for it? And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with people. God will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them in their what? As their God, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And so we wait for those times. And in these times, we take comfort in that God is already working. God does not wait for someday to give us comfort, but God chooses to give us comfort this day. And so I hope and pray that you will all, in your own way, feel the embrace of God in this time of worship. And now I'm going to bring the prayers to you. I'm going to put my mask on so I can get a little closer. I'm going to hold a microphone out as you raise your hand. And if you would do the folks, Megan especially, if you do them a favor, they're writing down our prayers to be shared with the community. So if you just start by saying your first name and then tell us what your prayer is about, that'll be an easier way for us to know what's going on around here and to be able to hold you up. I want to start by giving a thanksgiving. There was a wedding yesterday. It happened. All right. Thanks be to God. Oh, hi, Jen.
I'm Jennifer, and I'd like to thank all the veterans in our congregation and in our community for the service they have given to this country. So thank you, veterans.
And my tradition is that we ask the veterans to stand, and then we clap. But I guess we could clap twice.
Sure.
Do we have veterans among us? We want to honor you personally.
All right.
Hi, Dean.
I'm Dean, and lest we forget the 17 missionaries that are still in captivity in Haiti.
You all are learning to know me. We've got the whole congregation pointing to Megan right now.
I just have a huge praise for science because my kiddo is vaccinating on Monday, and I know there's so many other families who feel really excited about that. So.
Since we are celebrating saints, I would like to because Colin Powell was a veteran and he just passed, I would like to remember a saint like that. Our country needs unity and peace and people who have faith in God and are godly. Thank you.
They're getting warmed up.
start here, and then I'll be back here.
I have a prayer of thanks. After 35 years of government service, I finally retired. So.
I am Roger, and Kathy and I celebrate our 43rd anniversary on the 11th.
My name is Tim, and this morning when I walked in the fellowship hall, I saw something that I haven't seen in several years. Our carpet looks beautiful. Thank you.
Did anyone else notice? I think that's worth a thank you, trustees and UMW. All right, let us.
Yay, ducks.
We don't care about the ducks. Pray for the Huskies, they certainly need it. All righty, let's pray. Gracious Lord, for this day to be together, we thank you. You know, Lord, we need every bit of time we can have, and that extra hour was just what I needed. Every bit of time, Lord, is precious. Help us to hang on to it, to make the most of it. Help us to love our friends and our family while they are close, and help us to remember and admire them in our memories when they are no longer with us. Lord, I thank you for this day and for all of the great cloud of witnesses that will enter this space with us. We can feel the presence already. And most of all, Lord, we know that the risen Savior is with us. And he will wipe the tears from our eyes. And he will be with us wherever we go. If we are in the dark valleys, he will be there. And Lord, he will even laugh at our silly jokes. And say, thanks be to God, there is still laughter, and there still is hope, and there still is a tomorrow. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Have those children come up right now because I'm ready for them. And the good news about this day is the kids get to stay with us the whole service. Although Lily and, well, we can't send out Dale because Dale's joining the church. All the more reason to stay around. How are you guys? Can you hear me okay? All right. Well, you've got a whole lot of pictures around you. I bet you have pictures at your house too, right? Pictures of people that you see a lot, and sometimes pictures of people that you'll never see, right? I have pictures of my grandma in my house and my brothers and my friends. And it's always exciting to look at the pictures and remember all of the good stories I have about those people. And sometimes those stories are stories that I don't really think I was there, but other people have told me those stories.
And so today in our church, and almost every time we get together, we share a whole bunch of stories. And so most of these people, you will never even know what we're talking about. But in the middle of the story is usually remembering somebody that we love and somebody who's done something special. And so that is a way to get to know God a little bit better. Because whenever someone acts in a way that's kind and thoughtful, we think they are showing us a little bit about God, and we are thankful. Now, I really like books a lot, and I was thinking Lily's got a couple of boys she's going to keep a good eye on today, right? We've got a couple of other boys that are going to stick with Mom over here. I think that'll be good. I think Mom will like to have you around for this one time. Maybe longer than one time. I don't know. So I brought something for you. This is one of my favorite books. I found it a week ago. Do any of you know this book? No? Well, I might ask you some questions about this book later, guys. But if you don't have the answer, it's really okay. So I'm not going to have time, I don't think, to read this whole book. We'll see. It says, once upon a time, a shoemaker lived with his wife above the workshop, the place where he works. Once upon a time, a shoemaker lived with his wife in a little place above his workshop. And in a minute, it's going to tell us, and they were really not having a very good time because they couldn't make any money. They were making shoes that nobody wanted to buy. I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't want to read everything in the middle. It's just easier when I'm ready to go to bed just to read the first page and maybe the last. What do you think? The shoemaker and his wife never saw the little elves again, but their troubles were over. And they had a good and happy life together. The end. What do you think of that story? Is that the best one you've ever heard? I think all the best stuff is probably in the middle, don't you? Yeah, in the stuff that you don't see. And I'm thinking some of the best stuff about your lives are in the times that I don't see you. Because you leave here on Sunday and you go have a big life. And you have lots of good things, and I don't even know about that. So I look forward to hearing stories about what you do when you're not here. Like running around and playing with your friends, okay? And maybe going to school. So we will maybe not do that today, but hopefully another day we'll get to tell stories. Okay, and sometimes those will have pictures. If you want to bring pictures to show me, I would love to see them. I would love to see a picture of your grandma, because I've been praying for her. All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for these children and for their families. Thank you for bringing them into our midst. And Lord, we see their faces and we love them and we pray for them. And Lord, we long for more information. We long to hear the stories of how we can encourage them and how we can celebrate with them. And Lord, we thank you for the time that we will have to do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Good morning, my family of saints, my people who come here every week, every month, every year, and over 30-some years have really helped me become more me, and I thank you for that. Ministry news. I'm not going to dwell on this. I know you all can read, but the highlights are, we're doing the food drive for Neighbors Helping Neighbors, and this has been a long time custom here. So please bring what you can. When I talked to Pam at Neighbors Helping Neighbors, she said they could use money just as much as they could use food, because money kind of helps them fill in what the donations of food have missed. If you want to donate funds, make your check payable to Neighbors Helping Neighbors. We'll collect all the stuff up and deliver it to them in a couple of weeks. The Journey Book Study. Whoop, whoop, book study coming. There's the hardbound copy. There's the softbound copy. There's a pile of these available if you want one. This starts on Wednesday, includes some DVD, and will be another Zoom study, which is kind of nice because I don't know about you, but I don't like driving in the rain in the dark. And also on a Zoom, people don't have to wear masks, so that makes it kind of fun. And then last thing, newsletter time. This month's newsletter has gone out, so check out your emails, the website, and some printed copies are available. So that's all the ministry news I have for you this morning, because we want to get on to some really super-duper stuff. If some very lovely people would come forward, and that would be Dale Castle, Deanne Liska, and Sally Morris, because these lovely ladies have indicated that they would like to be part of this congregation, and we are so happy for that.
I'm trying to figure out how to do this and keep my mask on. You all know Jan. Jan is our lay leader at this church. But also, you may not know that Tyler is also our lay leader. We have a lovely balance here. We're trying to represent different aspects of our community as we gather. We want to hear what it's like for Tyler's family as they are part of this church, for Jan and Bob and their family as they are part of this church. And we look forward to hearing from all three of you what it's like for you to be part of this church, because we don't want just to add your name to a list that Joyce, wave your hand. Where did you go? There. Joyce will record from today and forevermore. We want to see your faces, and we want to know what it looks like to incorporate you into our community. We want to know how we can pray for you, and we want to know how we can equip you for ministry. And sometimes we'll get to do that ministry with you, and sometimes you'll be doing it just across town, and we'll hear about it, and we'll be thankful. All righty. So we're going to put up on the board what I did, because it took me 20-something years to figure out. The vows in the traditional hymnal are very confusing to figure out. They put together baptismal vows with confirmation vows, with membership vows, with transfer vows, and oh my gosh, I never get it right. Today we're going to get it right because we're going to do it together. All right. We're going to go line by line, and you guys are just going to say yes. Unless you want to say no, and then you can. We won't care. All right, ladies. I ask you now, in the presence of your congregation, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever form they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord? Will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? Will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? Will you faithfully participate in our ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? We're getting to the end. Will you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments? What else we got, Megan? Is that it? That's all? That's not very much. Do you have any vows that they should also agree to? Will you love the Lord with all your heart, your mind, and your spirit? And will you love your neighbor as yourself?
Yes.
Amen. Okay. Jan says it's good.
It's good. Will you join me in the communal prayer that you'll find in your bulletin? As members together with you
in the body of Christ,
and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome, new members.
You get to take your, thank you, Tyler. If you'd like to take your masks off and so we can clap for you and know who you are. So we have Sally and Dale and Deanne.
Then if you'll.
Great to be here worshiping our God with each and every one of you. This morning's scripture comes from John 11, verses 32 through 44. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how we loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now remain seated as we sing our hymn of preparation. "Here I am, Lord."
My hand will still.
Here we are, folks. How many months have we been in COVID? A whole long time. A whole lot of time. How many hours have we been in this service? Not long enough. There's still a whole lot of good stuff yet to go. All right. What do we do when we're not with one another? Well, one of the things I love to do on a Sunday afternoon, when I'm not taking a nap, I like to go shopping. And I never want to spend a whole lot of money on a Sunday afternoon because I'm not paying much attention. Usually I'm thinking through what has just happened in all my interactions with folks and trying to sort it all out so that I can place what I used to know with what I now know and then with what I'm supposed to be doing next. And so the Goodwill is my sanctuary, and if the I don't know where that book went, but it's okay. On the back of it, you'll see a little Goodwill sticker that I think I spent up to $3 on that book. There's another book I spent a dollar on that's pretty valuable, the Message Bible. I kind of like the Message Bible's translation of this John passage, and actually most of John. So when you get a moment, take a look at that. But let me tell you about last Sunday. As I was thinking about all of you and not yet ready to deal with this next week, I was shopping. I only found one thing, and it was all of $10, which was a big day for me. I get to the checkout line. There were two cashiers, which was lovely because the woman, two people in front of me had a great big cart full of Christmas decorations. While I was in the store, they had a sale on Christmas trees. All Christmas trees were $5. You can imagine they were going quickly. As well as every other imaginable Christmas thing in the store. And so there was a woman that was taking quite some time over to my right. And as you know, I don't see so well over there, so I just knew that she was there for a while, right? And here the woman in front of me goes through. People don't pay much attention to her. She's fairly quiet, but she stops at this other cashier on her way out the door and just hands her a little slip. Keeps going out the door. I ring up my big deals of the day. I check out just in time for the other cashier to say, and your bill will be only $5 today. That woman before you just redeemed all of her credits. Now, the woman over here, English was not her first language, and I'm not sure she understood exactly what had just happened. I don't know that the cashiers knew exactly what had just happened, but I knew. And it's one of those things that you ponder in your heart this time of Christmas, that you tuck away as just a blessing you've been able to witness, to know that at some point in time you'll be able to share that blessing with someone else. And then perhaps that might just make all the difference in the world. Today's scriptures, today's worship are meant to be a blessing. Now, the John passage has all kinds of trouble in it. We have all kinds of ways we could go that are not very helpful. We have friends of Jesus who have been calling out to him. Their brother, Mary and Martha, their brother has been sick. Jesus could have come and helped. They know that. Their brother has died. It's been 4 days since he's died, and Jesus was not there. We know that in Jewish culture that for 3 days the spirit, the soul hovers in around the body. That's why they have mourners that come and pray and wail, hoping to convince that spirit or that soul to return to the body. Just please, please, please don't let this be true. The mourners were almost ready to go, and here comes Jesus. It's too late for him to be at the party, and yet here he is. Mary can't help herself but to fall before him, to fall on her knees before him. She still loves him. If you'll notice, Lazarus doesn't have any lines in the story. We often refer to this as the raising of Lazarus, but all the action, all the lines belong to Mary and Martha and the community. Mary and Martha firmly believe that this is the Messiah, this is the Son of God, this is the great teacher. Should he choose to do something, God would certainly intervene and help. And they are hoping and they are believing. And so when the NRSV gives us the translation, if you only believed, the Message Bible says, let's change that to trust. Of course they believe, but just trust. If you only trust, that in time God will tend to your needs, perhaps that will help, if you only trust. Jesus is here and the community is here and we are caught up in grief. Guess how appropriate that is for today. As we are caught up in grief. As we are going to name 14 people that we know by heart. A couple of them we were able to have full memorial services for, but not most of them. How many lives have we known about that we have not been able to grieve together? And then as those numbers rise, how many thousands of people, Roger, you keep track of the numbers, how many people around the world have died of COVID? 5 million. We're up to the record books now of most disastrous pandemics. How many people have died alone? How many people have died without being able to be grieved? How many people have grieved alone? I think the sheer thought of it is overwhelming. For those of you who have lost loved ones, I know that's most of you here. And as you've done your very best, I hope you've been able to trust that Jesus had not abandoned you. And I hope that if not by now, then someday you will experience God's presence in your life again. And that presence will give you a sense of peace. We are people of the word, and we are people of community. And the community for us is often the body of Christ. We celebrate when we read the centering message in Revelation. We celebrate that our loved ones have joined Jesus in fellowship in heaven. But that is not what this passage is about. If you look at the beautiful picture that we had a really hard time fitting on this piece of paper, at one point Jesus looked a lot like Buddha, but I'm hoping that's not the case anymore. We got him straightened out a little bit. We have the Trinity in the middle with Jesus the Son, Jesus and God the Father, and then the Holy Spirit. We have Mother Mary. We have the different disciples, and we have the great cloud of witnesses. If I were in an Orthodox tradition, this would be my goal every time there was communion, which is every time we meet. We're going to read the liturgy, we're going to sing together, and we're going to come into the great cloud of witnesses. That is why they gather. That is why we gather today. To join our hearts and our minds and our spirits, knowing that in that joining, that we will share one another's burdens and that God will heal us. The centering thought for today, though, takes us to a different place altogether. It takes us to a second coming of Jesus. Because you notice that we are not going up, but God is coming down. The New Jerusalem is God making God's place among the people of this earth. The New Jerusalem is restoring creation to what it was meant to be, where there is no more pain, there is no more sorrow, where we live together in harmony, and don't we all want that? It's what we pray every time, every Sunday, or every other time we pray the Lord's Prayer. Thy will be done. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Right? That's what we pray for. And as disciples, whether you've been here a day or your whole life, that is what we work for, to bring the kingdom of heaven to earth. There are two favorite parts. They're, I think, actually in some of the games, like the shortest verses in the Bible. He wept and he stinketh. Who wept? Jesus did. Why did Jesus weep? Why did Jesus? Jesus knows that death is not the end of it. Jesus is God, for heaven's sakes. Jesus knows that he can say something and do something just as Mary and Martha did, that if Jesus would just do something, death would not matter anymore. But yet Jesus weeps. Because it's a natural thing and it's a right thing to mourn the loss of people we love. And to see the loss and the grief of people we love and to mourn. It matters. How dare we try to put an end to that for anyone ever? We can cry along with. We can love along beside. And we allow there to be life in the weeping. Jesus also wept for himself, I'm sure. And for the pain that death causes, the pain that death will cause to his family and his friends when he will die. And what that will be. But now let's get to the stinketh part, because that's also really good. Who stinketh? Lazarus. And so I get one more silly story to throw in here. It's a story of when I lived in Seattle, and I had my first SUV, because I was told in Ohio that if you moved to Seattle, you got to have an SUV. I don't know why I was told that. I was. I had to get an old one. I got an old one. And it was used once a month. This SUV was filled to up to the top with casseroles, because the church would go down to Operation Night Watch, was downtown Seattle, and we would feed hundreds of people,
as they were waiting to get shelter for the night. And it was a wonderful time of just sharing bread and being the body of Christ. And we loved that. And one of my saints, Rosalie Simpson, I'll shout out, taught me how to make a whole lot of food out of not very much money, because that's what she did in the UMW and beyond. Well, there were nights when we didn't get back till past midnight, and I was really tired, and I left the unclean pans in the car. And guess what? After a few years of doing that, my car stinketh. And then there was baby Sarah, and because she was a baby, she would just throw things everywhere, like bottles of milk and snacks, and it would hide itself under things, because that's what happens. And it would stinketh. And there was a time when I had to find a new home for this car, and nobody wanted it. Who? Of course not. We had to just send it to the junkyard. I think the car dealership had to give us a little bit of money just to make us feel better about it, but it stinketh. It was gone. We celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, because in the resurrection of Jesus, the stinkethness of death goeth away. Do you know what I'm talking about? He overcame death, even death on a cross, is what we are told. But let's look at that little place in Bethany, that little home with his friends, Mary and Martha, and Lazarus, who invite him just a few verses later, invite him back for a meal to celebrate. And every good story in the Bible has a meal, and they all eat a whole lot, I'm sure. But in this meal, we're remembering that not too long ago, this place stinketh. And so as this meal is happening, at some point, Mary, the one who went and knelt before the feet of Jesus, even when she was very upset with him, she goes back and anoints the feet of Jesus and pours perfume all over them. And the story says, and the house was alive again. All you could smell was that perfume. I hope it was good perfume. All you could smell was the anointing oil. It filled not only their homes, but their memories. That is the grace of God. When we are able to find a way to overcome the very worst that life has to offer through sacrificial love, through the offering of everything that we have and every part of our being, we pour it before God, upon God's feet, and there is beauty again in the world. This is our call. Our call right now in the middle of craziness, out of control grief, is to find a way to bring back love and to offer a place of healing. And we are enough, and there is enough when we do this together. Thank you all for not only saying your vows, but living into them faithfully as best you can. We will go forth together as the saints of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Here I go over here, Tyler. Are you ready to move my mic? This is the good part, Jan. I'm really loving this part a lot. Here we go. Are you all ready? We're going to uncover everything. I don't think this has been used in a while. Yes, we're going to do the clouds of witness first. So no anything exciting except the clouds of witness. But I'm going to uncover everything, because we're inviting the clouds of witness to join us at the table. That's what we do here. Don't come back up here, Dean, and sit on this. Look what we got, folks. Do you see what we've got? This is beautiful. Thank you, Cora, and was it Nancy that was back there? Thank you for preparing this beautiful meal for us.
And so as we gather at the table, let us bring to our hearts those who have gone on before. Donald Woodward. George Darnell. Bonnie Peck. Janet Krause. Quentin Blohm. John Burroughs. And John was the father of Mary Matney. Quentin was the husband of Phyllis Mueller. Michael LaFleur. Family of the Greens. Richard Mills, husband to Susan. Jeannie Wallace. Ruth Berry. Juanita Kennedy. John Adams, the brother of Cora. And John Adams, the husband of Pat. They died within 24 hours of one another. And Theodore Amon, the son of Angela Price. And those we name before you, Lord. Does anyone want to shout anyone out? I say, Bejoy. And so since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, we gather before you, Lord, in all confidence and hope and trust that you are with us today, that you are with us as we celebrate this ancient ritual given to us by your Son, Jesus Christ. On that last meal in which he shared with his disciples, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you, Almighty God, and he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat of you of this, all of you, for this is my body given for you and for many. As often as you share this, remember me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, Almighty God, and he gave it to his friends. "Take and drink of this, all of you," he said. "For this is my blood of the new covenant, given for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you share this, remember me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we give you thanks and praise, Holy God. As we share this simple meal, may we share with you in the inheritance of your grace and of your mercy. And may we share with you in your call to love this whole wide world as you love it. Bless us and keep us in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to invite our servers to come forward as soon as I find my mask again. Wait. All right. I'm going to... Thank you, Jan. All right. Here we go. We're coming to you. Stay there. Though many throughout
are one body in this world. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we out the earth. We are one body in this one Lord. Many the gifts, many the words, one in the Lord.
saving mine for a time when I can enjoy it, which will be just 1 minute. As we depart today, we're going to start with the back row. The last shall be first. Don't forget that we do have a silent auction back there. There's some beautiful artwork. Take a good look. And greet one another safely, because I can't say get out. This is not a day for getting out. This is a day to be safe in one another's presence. Gracious Lord, I give you thanks for this day and for each and every soul that is represented here. And Lord, I give you thanks for our families, for those who have loved us, for those who have challenged us and helped us to find new ways to love. Lord, for all about this world that stinketh, we pray that the aroma of your grace, we know that the work of your love may overcome. Help us to see it. Help us to be it. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen. May God bless you and keep you. May God make God's face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Creator, the Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we